Good afternoon to you all. Like matter spiraling into a black hole, we see lots and lots of people moving and surging towards this auditorium right from 3 o'clock. And that in itself is a statement as to how much you love the subject and you love the speaker. And it's a great pleasure for us to welcome you all to this program, the monthly program called Kaapi with Kuriosity. And today's talk is about black holes by Dr. Ramesh Narayan. And we extend an extremely, extremely warm welcome to you, sir, for this program. And we have several distinguished people among the audience. Difficult to list out all of them individually to welcome, but we would like to extend a special welcome to Sri A.S. Kiran Kumar, who was the chairman of ISRO until about a week back. And he is the chairman of the governing council of this planetarium, and he oversees all the activities of the planetarium. It's a pleasure to welcome him to this again. We have Dr. Rajesh Gopakumar, director of ICTS, co-host of this program. We extend a warm welcome to him. And we have Parameshwaran Ajit and Vijay Kumar from ICTS. Now, it's become a bit of a tradition to introduce the planetarium activity, but I see that a large fraction of the people here are people who are very well versed with planetarium activities. So without breaking the tradition and at the same time not taking too much of its time, in a minute I would like to introduce the planetarium activities. So planetarium, as you know, runs the planetarium shows, and it is immensely popular amongst students and public equally. And over the last 22 years, some educational programs have begun here on an informal scale. And these programs have had a deep impact on science education landscape in Bangalore, at least. And also it has shaped the future of several of the science students and science-minded students, drawing them to a career in research. More than 100 have got into the PhD programs from several, and they're pursuing PhD programs in prestigious institutions, and they're also, some of them are serving as faculty in research institutes. So it's extremely gratifying that such programs have been going on here, and you have benefited over all these years. So in addition to these educational programs, we have several popularization programs, one of which is screening of science movies on Sundays, on the third Sunday of the month to be more precise, and several other programs. Please look up our website for a detailed introduction about planetarium activities. But this particular program, which we started about a year back, and ICTS has brought this program to the planetarium on several occasions, Kaapi with Kuriosity. So not only we get a good Kaapi to savor at the end of the talk, but all the talks have been immensely popular, raising our levels of curiosity month after month. So we are extremely thankful to ICTS for this, for choosing planetarium to host these talks. And with these, I think I will now request Dr. Rajesh Gopakumar, the director of ICTS, to give an introduction to ICTS as the next part of the program. Dr. Rajesh Gopakumar.
Thank you, Dr. Madhusudan, and welcome to all of you and all the distinguished guests that are here for this special event. As Dr. Madhusudan said, we are very happy to have be part of this activity with the planetarium since October 2016. We have been having these mostly here, and today's was, I believe, one of the record had one of the record responses, and so it's great to see only standing room kind of meeting audience for this talk. ICTS is a new institution in Bangalore. Many of you probably have heard me say this because I think many of you are regulars for our Kaapi with Kuriosity. But I just wanted to say that we just celebrated our 10th anniversary. But we actually are quite new in the sense that we moved to the campus of ICTS just 2.5 years ago. We have a young faculty who do research in a number of areas, like including black holes, and that's what our LIGO group, led by Parameshwaran Ajit and others, have been doing. But we have groups in various other areas as well. Vijay studies quantitative biology. We have people doing string theory and the quantum aspects of black holes. We have people in mathematics. We have in statistical and condensed matter physics and fluid dynamics. So a variety of areas in the theoretical sciences. But it's not just our research, which of course we have a number of institutions, excellent institutions in Bangalore doing research. In addition to our research, we have programs, long collaborative workshops various durations with researchers from around the world coming. Recently we had this 10th anniversary celebration, which celebrated the unity of science in getting researchers in a number of areas, and Ramesh was one of the distinguished speakers in that meeting. But we had people from theoretical computer science, mathematics, biology, physics, and astrophysics. So it was a very wide canvas. More than the programs, we also believe very strongly in outreach, and today's is one such event. In fact, this month, I think we've had a record number of outreach events. Last week, in fact, at the planetarium, again, maybe some of you were there, we had a lecture and a show in the planetarium dome by Professor Hiroshi Oguri from Caltech. A few days before that at ICTS, we had Kip Thorne as a lecture. If you missed that, it is now up on our YouTube channel. You can watch it. It's very exciting. It was a very exciting event for all of us who were there, but even when you watch it on YouTube, I think you will feel that excitement. The week before that, there was a panel discussion and public lecture by Robert Digraf. So we take our outreach very seriously in bringing to the general public what the importance of science, the importance of fundamental science, and how young generations, or many of whom many of you are part of, how you to sustain your enthusiasm to create awareness and to sort of get more people to do science. So that's something we believe strongly, and Kaapi with Kuriosity in a sense is our flagship event in this direction, and it has been great to partner with the planetarium, and Dr. Shailaja and Dr. Pramod, Dr. Madhusudan have been very welcoming and enthusiastic, so I really I'm very grateful for that. So that's more or less what I wanted to say about ICTS. I'll now call upon Professor Ajit to give an introduction to the speaker. So thank you very much.
So you can see I came prepared. Professor Ramesh Narayan is one of the world's foremost experts on astrophysical black holes. He is currently Thomas Dudley Cabot Professor of Natural Sciences at the Harvard University, and the senior astronomer at the Smithsonian Observatory at Harvard. In his long and illustrious research career, he has made important contributions to a variety of areas in astrophysics, including gravitational lensing, pulsars, gamma ray bursts, apart from black holes. Narayan is an elected fellow of many international societies, including the Royal Society, the American Association for the Advancement of Sciences, the World Academy of Sciences, the Indian Academy of Sciences, and a member of the National Academy of Sciences of the USA. On a lighter note, I should also say that Professor Narayan is very much a local boy. He grew up in Bangalore, and many of his classmates are here to celebrate this lecture. And he's also a renowned son of a renowned father, the son of Professor G.N. Srinivasan, one of the stalwarts of Indian science. Ramachandran, I'm so very sorry. Professor G.N. Ramachandran, I got too excited, sir. Yes. In fact, the academic blog that I have in office is named after him. So, I'm sorry, I got too excited. So we are very excited to have Professor Narayan talking to us today. So before we start this lecture, let me give it back to Rajesh.
So it's a somehow funny tradition that has happened in ICTS that before the lecture begins, we invite some distinguished guests to hand over a memento on behalf of ICTS to the speaker. So I would like to request Dr. Kiran Kumar to hand over the memento to Professor Ramesh Narayan. Okay, so now over to you, Ramesh.
Very good. Thank you very much for this really warm welcome. So thank you to Dr. Madhusudana, Rajesh, Ajit, Kiran for giving me the memento. For me, this is a real great pleasure. This planetarium, the first director was Dr. Vishveshwara. And he was my, not colleague, he was my group leader when I was at the Raman Research Institute here as a scientist. But it's more than that. I have so many links with Bangalore. So I did my MSc here, just a few kilometers from here in Central College. And several of my classmates are here. It's wonderful to see them. Kiran Kumar, who is, I think, the most famous man in this room, as you know, just retired as chairman of ISRO. He was my classmate, all of our classmates. But more than that, he and I used to sit next to each other for 2 years in Central College in the same room, every lecture. He or I, we never missed a lecture. We always were there. Some of these others, I don't know. But Dr. Shailaja was a classmate. She was a director of the planetarium, as you know. Dr. Shukre, who was also a director, was my colleague at Raman Institute. So, it's just too much. When I look at this place, it's so happy to be here. I got my PhD in Bangalore, a few kilometers in a different direction. I worked at NAL, it used to be called National Aeronautical Laboratory. And by the time I got my PhD, the administration had moved from the Central College complex to Kengeri. So I remember I had to go to Kengeri several times to persuade them to give me the degree. it took me 2 years. I had done my work, everything was done, but to get that piece of paper took 2 years. And then, of course, my post-PhD was in Raman Institute. Finally, I did go to the US. And it's been great there, but I have never forgotten Bangalore. This is just wonderful. And when I see all the public events happening now, I wish we had had all that. What do you say, Chandrasekhar? It would have been so nice if we could have had this kind of extra stimulus there. But I'm glad that it is now happening in Bangalore. It's such a stimulating environment for science. This, I think, can be a real crucible to develop the next generation of scientists, and I hope many of you will continue on and be scientists, bring India up. I'm going to talk about black holes. It's a very big, vast topic. I'm an astrophysicist, so it'll be more focused on astrophysical aspects of black holes. But even that is a huge topic. So I'm just going to say a few things. But we'll have, I think, an extended discussion time later on. So, you know, you can ask questions then, whatever interests you most, if it's not what I'm telling you. And, you know, we can go as long as you want. So let me start off. Probably you all know this. I'll just remind you what a black hole is. So before I go to the black hole, if you take any normal object, example the Earth, you know, it's got a finite size, it's got a finite mass, a finite density. There is a surface. You can say this is outside the surface, that is inside the surface. Quite normal. You know, this is also a normal object. It's got a surface, finite density, etc. A black hole is something different. It is an object, it has mass, okay? It's got mass. In fact, some of them are very massive. But all that mass is squeezed down into a point, a geometrical point. You know, in mathematics, we learn about a point which has no volume, no area, no anything. That's where all the mass is sitting. What has happened is gravity is so strong, it takes all the mass and squeezes it down to a point. So there's no real surface, and the density is infinite, but there's a finite mass. So instead of a surface, what you have is something called an event horizon. So this infinite density is what is called a singularity, so that's a characteristic of a black hole. And instead of a surface, you have a pseudo-surface, or a virtual surface, which is the event horizon. And this surface has the following property. Again, everybody has heard this. It is a point of no return. Things can fall in. So I can shine a ray of light through the horizon into the interior of the black hole, or I can throw this pointer, or I can fall in, or whatever. Things can go from outside to inside, but once you've gone inside, nothing will let you get out. You can have the most powerful rocket and try to accelerate out, you cannot make it out. There's only one-way street. Once you've gone in here, you will get pulled into the singularity and you will become part of the singularity. Infinite density, zero volume, etc. So this virtual surface, if you ask what is its radius, this is the characteristic number. This is called the Schwarzschild radius, after the famous scientist who found the first black hole solution. So if I have a black hole with a mass equal to the mass of the sun, that's the symbol for the mass of the sun, the radius of the sphere will be 3 kilometers. And it's proportional to the mass. So if I have a bigger black hole, say 10 times the mass of the sun, it'll be 30 kilometers, and so on. Okay, so that's the size of a black hole. Keep this in mind, because the size is going to become relevant towards the end of my talk. Okay, now, you look at this black hole, and you say, look, somebody is very crazy here. This doesn't look like science. This looks like science fiction, right? What's this infinite density? What's this one-way membrane and all this nonsense? The thing is, it is a direct consequence of very fundamental physics. Einstein, as you probably know, developed two versions of relativity. There's a special relativity, which we all learn fairly early when we do physics. And then there's a more complicated version of relativity, which includes gravity, called Einstein's general theory of relativity. And he developed this towards the end of 1915, and he wrote down the equations, and within a few weeks after he wrote the equations, Schwarzschild found an exact solution. Take the equations, you find a solution, and that is what today we call a Schwarzschild black hole. Okay, of course, Schwarzschild didn't know it was a black hole. He found the solution. It took scientists decades to understand the properties of that solution. But it is an exact solution. So it follows from very good, strong, basic physics. It's a solution of the equations. And there are other solutions discovered later on, 1960s, with generalized Schwarzschild. But even though it came from Einstein's own general theory of relativity, he never believed black holes because he didn't like these concepts. I think he was okay with the horizon. I don't think he liked this idea of a singularity where everything goes to infinite density. He thought something is wrong either with the theory itself or with our understanding of the theory. He thought something will come and save the day. In this matter, he was wrong, because black holes are real. They may be weird, but they are real. And we have seen many, many of these in the universe. So in the universe, astronomers have found black holes. And we have basically seen two kinds of black holes. One is a category called supermassive black hole. So these are very, very massive. So each of these black holes will have a mass somewhere between 10 to the 6 and 10 times the mass of the Sun. And the Sun itself, as you know, is almost a million times the mass of the Earth. So that's a huge mass. And then there is a second class of black holes called stellar mass black holes, which are few to few tens of solar masses. Now these guys, the supermassive black holes, the way we often detect them is through radiation. So these are so-called galactic nuclei or active galactic nuclei, and I'll just tell you very briefly. What you have is a whole galaxy, and right in the middle of that galaxy, this supermassive black hole seems to be sitting. There's one in our galaxy, and as far as we can tell, every other galaxy in the sky has got one of these guys, a supermassive black hole. Most of these black holes, they keep drawing in gas from the surroundings. Galaxies have got gas, and the gravity of the black hole pulls some of that gas in, and what happens is the gas goes into orbit, circles round and round the black hole, and finally falls into the black hole, and disappears through the event horizon. And as I told you, once it's gone through the horizon, you're not going to see it. But along the way, this gas becomes very hot. And this is simple physics. You're taking material at some large radius and you're dropping it into a deep potential well. It's a very deep potential well at the black hole. During that process, some of this energy gets converted to thermal energy, heat. And that hot gas will radiate and we see the radiation. So this stuff will be radiating in ultraviolet, optical, X-rays, radio, all sorts of waves, electromagnetic radiation. And that is what we observe and have been observing now for more than 50 years. These are objects called quasars and blazars and Seyferts. They've got many, many different names, radio galaxies and all that. So all of these wonderful things, they're all supermassive black holes. The radiation is just the power being released as gas falls in. And as I say, these guys, there is one per galaxy, always in the very center. These guys, smaller ones, there are lots and lots of them. So in fact, probably our galaxy has got more than 10 to the 7 of these smaller black holes. Most of them are very dark. You don't see them. So I should remind, maybe it was not obvious, I should tell you again. When I say that these are very bright, you're seeing the radiation from the gas before it falls into the black hole. It's not the black hole that's shining. It is the potential energy being converted to light that you're seeing. These guys, many of them are just floating around in the galaxy, we think, okay? And we can't see any radiation from them. But a small handful of them happen to be in binary systems. There's a black hole, there's another star. The two of them are going around each other under the effect of gravity. Some gas gets transferred. You form an accretion disk. This is what it's called, this business of gas going around and falling in. That's an accretion disk. And it becomes very bright, and we see them in X-rays. They're called X-ray binaries. I'm not going to say anything about these objects. It's a huge field in its own right, but today I'm going to be focusing only on the big black holes. This is an artist's picture. This is also an artist's picture, okay? And you'll see that in both pictures, there is something sticking out here. This is called a jet. This is something that seems to happen. You have a black hole, gas is flowing in. The black hole is trying to pull the gas in, but somehow in the process, some of the gas gets ejected out perpendicular to the disk with very large velocity, almost the speed of light. This is, you know, big blobs of gas are being shot out. These relativistic jets seem to be a big part of this whole accretion phenomenon. We see them in the quasars and blazars, and we see them in the X-ray binaries, and so on. Okay. Now, let me remind you, this is not what I'm going to talk about today, but this is the great excitement of the last couple of years when physicists have finally directly detected gravitational waves. You must have heard of LIGO. Rajesh mentioned that Kip Thorne, he gave a public lecture, brilliant talk. You really should go and listen to that talk since it's on YouTube. Wonderful, wonderful talk. He gave a talk on this work. He and two others got the Nobel Prize just this year for this discovery. This was done by something called LIGO, laser interferometry gravitational wave observatory. I'm not going to talk about that. This is not electromagnetic radiation. This is gravitational waves, a completely new kind of radiation that was discovered by LIGO. But this Nobel Prize was for everything. Detection of gravitational waves, making the instrument work, the first black hole binary. It was just a remarkable discovery. And I just showed some pictures related to that discovery. I won't say more about this. Everything I'm going to tell you today is electromagnetic waves coming from accreting gas, accretion and also the jets. That is my story today. Okay. Now here is something very interesting about black holes. They may be big, they may be massive, but they are extremely simple. If I had a black hole and I wanted to describe it, I need to give you only three numbers. It has a certain mass, and I already told you that mass is sitting in that singularity somewhere in the center. A black hole can be spinning. If it is spinning, it has an angular momentum. So I can give you a number, angular momentum, or if you want to be very precise, I can also give you a direction for the spin axis. In addition, a black hole can have electric charge. That's this number Q. And once I've given you these numbers, there's nothing more I can tell you about that black hole. It is the simplest possible macroscopic object in physics. Okay? It's like a microscopic particle. If I gave you an electron, right? How do you describe the electron? You'll give it a mass, you'll give it the spin half or whatever, you'll say it's got some charge, maybe a magnetic moment. You know, there are only some few handful of numbers you can give. This guy may be 10 to the 10 times more massive than the sun, but at the end of the day, three numbers will completely describe it for you. All the other details disappear, okay? That's what makes this so beautiful. It's the most beautiful, simplest, most powerful object in all of physics, at least macroscopic physics. So somebody with a good sense of humor developed something called the no-hair theorem. And basically they said a black hole has no hair. And I'll try to explain the idea behind this, okay? Where does the hair come in? So you all know that Einstein had a lot of hair, right? He is famous for that. Apart from all the good physics, he was also famous for his hair. So let's say I gave you Einstein, and you want to describe Einstein, okay? Apart from all the brain and the, you know, cleverness and all that, just start by, let's try to describe his hair, okay? So you have to take every one of these little things sticking out, and you have to give its, you know, details. What are the coordinates where it is attached? How long is it? How is it wiggling? Is it sticking out this way or that way? What is this color, thickness? You can imagine, right? And how many hair he's got. So you're going to need a huge number of numbers just to describe his hair. If I gave you a black hole, the maximum you can do is have three hairs. You can say, okay, one hair is one number mass, one hair is one number angular momentum, one hair is one number electric charge. And then you're finished. No more hairs. So really, it's not a no-hair theorem, it's a three-hair theorem, okay? A black hole can have at most three hairs. Astrophysical black holes, the ones that I'm talking about, in fact, are even simpler. They're only two hairs. Because, you know, we have good reasons to think you can't keep an electric charge permanently on a black hole. Even if you put a charge, you know, there's so many free-floating charges in the universe, they'll get drawn in and neutralized. So at the end of the day, our black holes only have two numbers. There's a mass and there's a spin. And everything you see, apart from the accretion disk, of course, but any property related to the black hole, end of the day, has to be described in these two numbers. It's a great challenge for us in astronomy. It has to be a simple explanation, and yet when you look at the data, it's horribly complicated. All the things that nature does, somehow it has to be boiled down to two numbers. Okay. Let me just say a little bit about mass. Okay, we can measure masses of many black holes. So I want to give you just one simple explanation how you can do it. This is basic physics, right? We all know if I've got some mass m and I go to some radius r, the gravitational acceleration at this point is gm over r squared. So I want you to imagine the following. I've got some massive object, and I'm putting some test particle on a circular orbit around this mass. And we have all done this calculation. I think anyone who's done even basic physics, mechanics, would have done this calculation. You equate the acceleration due to gravity with this centrifugal force or centrifugal acceleration, v squared over r. V is the velocity of the particle in the orbit. And if you rewrite this, what you find is m is equal to v squared r over g. So if you know the velocity of the particle, and you know how far away it is from the center, and assuming it's a circular orbit, and you know the gravitational constant g, you can measure the mass of what's in the middle without ever going there, right? This is the beauty. And this is, in fact, exactly how we measured the mass of the sun. Nobody has gone to the sun, but already Newton, maybe not Newton, Newton knew how to do it, but we had to wait for Cavendish to measure this g. But, you know, already with basic physics, we knew the mass of the sun basically by just looking at the motion of the Earth. The Earth is almost circular orbit. We know how far we are from the sun. We know that we are going around at 30 kilometers per second. You can write it also in terms of the period, 1 year. You put all this in, there's the mass of the sun, 2 times 10 to the 33. Right? It's beautiful. Now, you also probably know that the circular orbit is very special. The more general orbit is an elliptical orbit. If you have a bound particle, it goes generally in an elliptical orbit. And there is a small generalization of this formula, which works beautifully for elliptical orbits as well. Great. You can play the same trick with a distant black hole. So this is really famous, beautiful work done on the supermassive black hole in our galaxy. It's got a name. It's called Sagittarius A star. It's a compact object, center of our galaxy. This is showing actual, you know, kind of idealized version of real data. You're looking at the center of the galaxy with your telescope. This needed new technology, I should tell you. It needed infrared technology to do this work properly. But it became available about 25 years ago. So in fact, around 1990 or so, it started. This is the actual year, okay? So as a function of time, you're looking at the center of the galaxy, and these are all individual stars. Stars are all moving around. And normally, if a star is moving, it'll just go in a straight line. But in the center of the galaxy, it's not moving in a straight line. Look at this guy. It's going like this. It's curving and going off. This one is curving. And this is the most famous one, the first one that they measured. Look at that. It's doing that. It's doing a nice, perfect ellipse. So you look at the stars. Each of them is going on an elliptical path. It looks like there is some gravity pulling it. Okay? This was done by a German group, Skodel et al. This is a US group. It's the same object. Once again, the center is there. Look at all these guys. This is the first one. Here is one that came. Here is one that came. And you look at these data and you say, look, this looks like gravity is doing something. Let me assume that this star is being pulled by gravity at some location. Where should I put this object with mass, and how massive should it be? Well, the answer is, you need a dark object with a mass of 4 times 10 to the 6 solar masses, and it should be located exactly at that star, or the X in the previous movie. And the wonderful thing is, you do this for one star, then you see another guy. Look at this guy. This guy came and went like that. You say, let me try and solve this orbit. It's another ellipse. You solve it. It says, I need a mass of 4 times 10 to the 6 at this location. Every one of these stars gives you exactly the same answer. And that's when you get the confidence that what you're seeing is real. There is something dark, massive, and highly gravitating sitting right here, and it's pulling all the stars around in elliptical orbits. So we know the mass of the supermassive black hole in our galactic center, 4 times 10 to the 6. Actually, by now, they probably have the next digit. I'm not 100% sure, because you also need to know the distance of the galactic center, and that's still a little uncertain. Let's call it 4 times 10 to the 6. There are, of course, black holes in other galaxies. You can't do such beautiful measurements on some other galaxy. They're too far away. But astronomers have other methods, slightly more approximate, but still you can believe the numbers. And that's where you get the statement I made already, namely that supermassive black holes have masses in this range. Actually, our galaxy has a pretty weak, wimpy black hole. There are some not very far from us that are up to 10 to the 10 solar masses. Okay? Huge. It's a whole range here. four orders of magnitude. Okay. Now, what can you do with the mass? About 15 years ago, when enough masses had been measured, people made a rather surprising discovery. What they found was the black hole mass in the, this is the black hole in the center of the galaxy, that black hole mass is somehow related to the overall galaxy itself, right? In particular, if you measure the mass of the black hole, and then you go and measure, let us say, the mass of the galaxy or the radiative luminosity of the galaxy or something else, this is what astronomers normally measure, the so-called velocity dispersion. They're all related to each other, okay? Each is a measure of how much stuff is in the galaxy. There is a nice correlation. This is a log-log plot, and even though it's not exactly on a line, you can see that there is a pretty linear correspondence between this guy and that guy, extending over many orders of magnitude. So when this was discovered, people immediately realized this has to be a clue, important clue, about how things worked in the universe. Because these supermassive black holes, I should tell you, they were formed long ago. Most of them were formed more than 10 billion years ago. The galaxies were also formed, you know, billions of years ago. But somehow they formed, they came together with a black hole sitting in the middle, and they are related to each other. A smaller galaxy has a smaller black hole, bigger galaxy has a bigger black hole. And it seems to be a fairly tight correlation. So the question is, why? You might be saying, what's the big deal? Of course, they should be related. They are sitting in the same galaxy. But in fact, there is a reason to be surprised. But let me come to that as I go along. To understand this correlation a little better, I'm going to show a few pictures and define a few terms for you. So a galaxy, a black hole I've already defined for you. A galaxy, what's this galaxy? A galaxy is a big, loose object bound by gravity with different kinds of components sitting in it. So a typical galaxy will have stars, like our sun. You know, our sun is part of our galaxy. You might have noticed that I keep waving my hand. If I wave this hand, the sound is going to be very variable. I hope you can handle it. I'll try and hold it, okay? So a galaxy has got stars. It's got gas. So in fact, our galaxy has got gas. In fact, the gas makes stars. Stars eject gas. It's a very beautiful, intricate, complicated interplay in a galaxy. And there is something called dark matter, which in fact dominates most of the mass is in this thing called dark matter. We won't go into the details, but all of this is present in a single galaxy, and they're all bound together by gravity. Now, galaxies themselves come in two main categories. There are so-called elliptical galaxies, and there are so-called spiral galaxies. I'm going to show you some pictures. Elliptical galaxies are the simple ones. They're just big balls, mostly of just stars. They don't have much gas. So here is an elliptical galaxy. There are probably 10 to the 12 stars there, okay? Huge number. It's all bound together with gravity. Here is another elliptical galaxy. It's a little bit of stuff here. This is actually gas and dust, but it's a minor component. This is an elliptical. This is also mostly an elliptical with some extra stuff sitting in a disk of some sort here. Contrast this with the spiral galaxies. These are the beautiful galaxies, okay? Look at this one. It's just incredible. There is a concentration, a ball of stars in the middle. This is called a bulge. Okay, so this, all these spiral galaxies have got a bulge in the middle. In addition, something came on, okay. in addition, there's all this stuff. This is all a disk of material with stars and gas and everything. And surrounding the whole thing is dark matter. So I would for my purpose of my talk, we should just focus on this bulge. The rest of it is all extra. As far as the black hole is concerned, supermassive black hole, it seems to know something about the bulge. So there's this bulge in the middle, whereas in the case of the elliptical, we'll call the whole elliptical as the bulge. And what the data are telling us is, if you look at the black hole mass, and you look at the mass of the central bulge, the bulge of stars, there is a nice relation between the two. How did this happen? First of all, I should tell you, why are we surprised? I'll come to this again in a few slides. The black hole, we say it's 10 to the 8 solar masses in mass or whatever. It's still tiny compared to the galaxy, okay? The galaxy will be 1,000 times more massive than the black hole. It's like, it's a huge big brother, and this is just this little fellow sitting in the middle. If you look in terms of the size, the horizon size of a black hole is probably a billion times smaller than the size of the galaxy. There's such a difference in scale. That is what's surprising. When there is such a huge difference in scale, why should there be such a correlation between the two? Here is one story that is kind of, I won't say it's proved, but this is kind of becoming more and more accepted today. The story goes as follows. If you look at the life of the universe, stars are formed, galaxies form, somehow or other these black holes also form. Galaxies, once they are formed, do not retain their identity for too long. They start interacting with each other. They're big objects. Every now and then they go near another galaxy and they start ripping each other apart. They merge. We actually see pictures. Here is two galaxies, before merging. They're going to merge in the next billion years probably. Here is one that has already merged. You can see. This guy was probably coming like this. It went through the center of this guy. It's going to become a single object in the future. So these kinds of things happen a lot in the universe. And we can even study what they will do. So here I have got a movie of one of these things. In astrophysics, we study a lot of the processes using computer simulations. You all know computers. This is a great application of computers. You'd use big supercomputers, code up all the equations, and you run it, and you pretty much run the universe on the computer. And so here is one piece of the universe, two galaxies approaching each other. Both of them are spirals, disk-like. And when they come together, their mutual gravity pulls and distorts and does all sorts of stuff. In fact, this almost looks like one of the photos I showed you earlier. You remember? This is what it does. And if you watch this, keep watching it, each of these guys has got a black hole in the middle, okay? Finally, what's going to happen is I'm going to make one galaxy. These two black holes are going to come together. And when they come together, they make a kind of an explosion. This is this quasar or whatever, Large amount of gas is going to be accreted. Look at that. Look at all that stuff. This black hole is tiny, but it's modifying such a large volume. This is the story that people are now beginning to believe. When mergers happen, black holes come together. During a brief period, they eat a lot of gas. And when they eat gas, they are very powerful, right? They produce all this radiation. They produce these jets. All this goes and affects the rest of the galaxy. And the galaxy is forced to adapt its properties as, to be consistent with the black hole. So there is a communication between the black hole and the galaxy. And at least the way I understand this story, even though the galaxy may be 1,000 times more massive than the black hole, the black hole is the boss. The black hole tells the galaxy what it should do. It says, okay, I have so much mass, you can be 1,000 times more massive, but not more. If you try to go bigger, I'll blow you up. Okay, so that's what is going on here. Okay, so this is kind of a, I won't say it's a completely accepted story, it's the most popular story right now. This still leaves us with this problem. How can a black hole affect something 10 to the 9 times larger? If you look in terms of volume, it's 10 to the 27 times larger, okay? 10 to the 9 in length, 10 to the 27 in volume, 10 to the 3 in mass. All these numbers are crazy. How can this little fellow do it? It's to give you an analogy. This is like putting an object as big as a grape in the center of our Earth and then saying that that grape will decide what the Earth is supposed to do. You know, it just doesn't make sense. How can it do that? Well, what's going for us is the fact that a black hole is very powerful. I already told you there is this deep potential well. So every time gas goes in, it produces a huge amount of energy. So energy is available, but you have to get it. You have to push that energy back into the galaxy and communicate with the whole galaxy. It seems this happens through these jets. I already told you about the jets coming out. It is those jets, apparently, that are going out there with a lot of power and mixing up the galaxy and telling it what to do. Probably radiation also. Okay, I'm going to show you some pictures of these jets. This is a very famous picture of a jet. So there is a black hole here, okay? This black hole is about 10 to the 9 solar masses. There is a galaxy around it, which is about that big. These two lines that you see, these are the jets. So this black hole has been producing a jet for a billion years, and it is so powerful, it went all the way through the galaxy and went 10 times further and produced all this stuff. Okay, this is all radio waves. It's a radio image. It's a beautiful image. Famous object, Cygnus A. This is another guy, closer to us, M87. And here you can actually see, this is the black hole. This is the jet coming out. So we are looking closer to the black hole now. You can actually see something moving out. That's the beginning of the jet, way down here somewhere. And then it goes, carries off long way. There are zillions of these jets all over the universe. People have made beautiful pictures, images. This is the large scale image of the same guy, M87. This is the large scale view. The previous one I showed you was just right here in the middle, just the beginning of the jet. And then there are all these jets all over the place. So it looks like this jet is what is allowing the black hole to communicate with the galaxy and tell it what to do. We see the beginnings of the story. I don't think we have all of the story fully yet, but this looks like a promising idea, that it's the mechanical power coming out in the jet and other things related to the jet which are doing the work. One very brief comment. You can ask, why is there a jet? You know, black hole is pulling everything in. That is gravity. Why does it produce a jet? And why is the jet so powerful? It's like the black hole is sending energy out. It's supposed to swallow everything, right? How can it send energy out? We think, and there's good reason now to believe that this is the right story, that this is because of the second hair, right? I told you about mass. And I showed you the correlation of mass, galaxy, etc. But remember, black holes have got two hairs. Second hair is angular momentum. So a black hole can be spinning. And it turns out spinning black holes are different from non-spinning black holes. Spinning black holes, in some sense you can say, spinning black holes are a little more generous than the non-spinning black holes. Non-spinning black holes do only one thing. You throw something, it'll eat it, okay? It'll become a little fatter. Then you throw something, it'll get a little fatter. That's all it does. It's very simple but boring and greedy object. The spinning guy has got more character to it. It will also eat if you throw in stuff, but sometimes if you throw in things properly in their proper geometry, it can actually return energy outside. A spinning black hole has got some part of its energy in the form of what I would call thermodynamically free energy. There is some free energy associated with the spin part of a black hole, and that, under certain circumstances, can be removed from the black hole. So a black hole can actually supply energy, apart from eating stuff. And we think that is what is driving these jets. The spin of the black hole, and lots of details, magnetic fields in particular, I won't go into any of the technical stuff. That is where it appears this energy is coming out, and that's how you can get so much power coming out in these collimated structures. Okay, so spinning black hole can give back energy, and we think it gives back energy through these jets, in some cases at least, and that is where the power source is operating. Okay, now of course, you can make a story, but you want to verify it. So let's say I've got this hypothesis that black hole spin power produces powerful jets, and then the jets go and do something to give this correlation. How do I test this? Two ways. The straightforward way is find black holes in the universe. You've already, let us say you've measured the mass. Now you go and measure the spin of the black hole. Then you measure the power of the jet and see whether there is any relation between the spin of the black hole and the power in the jet. Unfortunately, this is very hard. See, mass is easy to measure. Spin is very hard. And a number of groups have tried, and they've made some measurements. And I put a question mark here saying that there is some preliminary evidence that jet power and black hole spin are correlated. More rapidly spinning black holes have got more powerful jets. But not everybody believes it. It's very preliminary evidence. The second way to test this is through computer simulations. This is beautiful. You know, it's just gas, magnetic fields going around a black hole. These are all standard equations, hydrodynamics, magnetohydrodynamics. We know how to do these things. We know the equations. And now we have the computers to actually do the full simulation. So you can actually throw gas into a black hole, watch it evolving on the computer, see what happens. You can do this with black holes of different spin. First of all, see whether it makes a jet. If it makes a jet, do you get a more powerful jet with a more rapidly spinning black hole or not? You know, think of the computer as an experimental device. You do experiments, test your hypothesis, see whether it all hangs together. This you can do, and in fact, it's been very successful, and I put this little tick mark here to say, this route has worked nicely. Many groups are now in a position to run simulations like this, and they do find jets forming. I'm just going to show you one movie. Just, you know, many of you, I mean, all of you, I'm sure, are very, very comfortable with computers, and some of you are probably going to get into programming and computer simulations and all that. There's a lot of beautiful work to be done in that area in science. So here is a simulation, and what you, this is my black hole. It's all being done on a computer. I've got a ring of gas around it, okay? It's in orbit around it, and I'm just letting it evolve, and you can see gas is kind of flowing in, but you'll also see that there is stuff going out. So these are all magnetic field lines. I won't dwell on this too long because I think running out of time. But basically, you can go into the computer, you can run this for a long time, and you can make measurements. Because you've got all the information on the computer, you can go cell by cell, instant by instant, you can go and measure how much power is coming this way, how much power is going this way, how much material is ejected, how is that power related to the spin of the black hole. You can do all of these calculations, and these kind of work, in fact, confirms that spinning black holes are excellent for making jets, and the more rapidly it is spinning, the more powerful the jet. So at least part of the story is hanging together. Okay. This is still theory, right? Even though I call it experiment on the computer, I'm just using my theoretical equations. We would like to actually see whether this actually works. Ideally, you know, if we had everything we wanted, what you would like is you would like to catch a black hole and go and make a movie of that very central region. Watch the gas coming. Watch the magnetic field coming. Watch the jet forming and shooting out. Right? This is when you'll really believe it. Obviously, this is extremely difficult. Black holes are, you know, they're so tiny. And they're all so far away. How are we ever going to do this? So, last part of my talk, I'm going to just deal with this question. I want to make a picture of a black hole. In fact, I want to make a movie of the black hole, okay? But first I'll start with one still picture. After I've succeeded with that, then I'll make a movie. Maybe 10 years from now. But first, let's start with the picture. So how do you make a picture of something that is really, really tiny? Obviously, you're going to need very, very advanced technology, very clever people coming up with very clever ideas. And you also need to have some idea of what you're expecting to see. So I'm going to show you one picture of an black hole. This is still computer simulation, but this is not from a scientific paper, but this is actually from a movie, Interstellar, if you have seen. Remember, there was a black hole there, and this is a disk. This is supposed to be a
flat disk in orbit around the black hole. And when you look at this object, it doesn't look like a flat disk. You see instead a ring. So you can ask, why am I seeing a ring? I think it's explained in the movie very briefly. But of course, this is a very well-known phenomenon. The physics is quite well understood. And I'll explain the physics in this previous slide. Gravity bends light rays, okay? So if I have a gravitating object and I shoot a ray of light past it, it won't go in a straight line. It'll get deflected by gravity. So this is the sun. If there is some light coming from a star, normally it would go that way, but it'll bend and reach like this. And if I were observing the star from the Earth, it will appear as if the star is not here, but it is there. It is shifted in the sky because of the bending of light. This was a prediction. Einstein's general theory of relativity, 1915, okay? Predicted and verified within a few years. This same phenomenon was verified. Star appeared to be shifted by, you know, an arc second or two arc seconds, whatever. A black hole is much more powerful, much stronger gravity than the sun. So in fact, near a black hole, the deflection is much, much more extreme. In fact, there is a special radius called the photon orbit where you can even have a light ray going round and round the black hole. The deflection is so much, it comes back to where it started from, okay? And like I like to say, if you're close enough to the black hole, on this orbit, you will see the back of your head, because a ray of light coming from the back of your head will go around and you'll see the back of your head in front of you, even though the light came from here, okay? Now, this is not quite the back of your head, but essentially what's happening here is you've got this flat sheet. Light that was emitted by this flat sheet behind the black hole went over the black hole, got bent, and then it reached me. So even though it's a flat sheet, I see it as if it's lifted up because that light went up and came to me. So this is all the flat disk on the other side of the black hole. This is also the same disk, but the bottom of the disk. So you're seeing the top of the disk here, the bottom of the disk here, and you see a beautiful ring, dark region in the middle, okay? This is something, this has nothing to do with the accretion disk. This is gravity operating. This is a property of gravity near a black hole. Whatever you put there will automatically develop these dark central dark regions. It's got a name. People call it the shadow of the black hole. And when I said I want to make an image, this is one of the things I'm looking for. There should be this dark region. If only I had a telescope that can resolve a black hole. And that's hard. So you can go and look at all the black holes we know in the universe and ask, which is the most, you know, most easiest object, okay, of all these candidates. And it turns out this fellow in the middle of our galaxy, Sagittarius A star, is the best candidate. It has got a mass of 4 × 10⁶ solar masses. And, you know, it's quite far away, but it's much closer than the other big guys, which are in other galaxies. It turns out that if you ask, if I take the horizon of this black hole, put it at the distance of that black hole and ask, what is its angular size? It is about 10⁻¹⁰ radians. Okay, it's a tiny angle. You know what a radian is? It's 10⁻¹⁰ of that. No easy business for an astronomer to resolve. All other black holes are much worse. You might know this very standard result from physical optics, wave optics, that if you have a telescope, there is a limit to how much angle it can resolve. The minimum angle that it can resolve is equal to, apart from the constant, lambda over d. Lambda is the wavelength of your radiation, d is the diameter of your telescope. This is why people like to build big telescopes. The bigger the telescope, the better angular resolution you can get. The shorter the wavelength, the better angular resolution. So optical is better than radio, et cetera, et cetera. So you can ask, given that this is what I want to measure, what wavelength and diameter can I use to make a useful image of a black hole? I don't want to resolve what's way out there. I want to look in the middle and see the shadow. Now, you can put the numbers and you'll find that this is pretty hard, okay? it turns out that there is one combination that's actually doable. If you use waves with a wavelength in millimeters, so in frequencies, these are a few hundred gigahertz, okay, for those of you who are familiar with the radio waves, fairly high frequency radiation, millimeter waves, and if you had a telescope as big as the Earth, now I'm talking nonsense again, then you know you will have enough resolution. So here is what we need. Millimeter waves, and people know how to do millimeter wave astronomy. That exists. But now you need a telescope as big as the Earth. Then you will have this resolution. Great. You will make pictures. You'll make movies. You know, it'll be wonderful. Now, you say, look, this is nonsense. But in fact, it's doable, but through a trick. Okay? Obviously, we're not going to have the whole Earth as a telescope. There is this wonderful concept called interferometry, which some of you might have heard of. But essentially, it is where you take two separate telescopes. So there's one telescope here, one telescope here, separated by some distance. And then you have to do something very clever, you know, a lot of very clever electronics and computation, correlations and all that. I won't go into any of the details. But if you do all the right things, you can combine the signal you receive here and the signal you receive here and get some information. And that information will be as if you had a telescope as big as this. Even though the individual telescopes are tiny, the separation is the effective size of this interferometer telescope. Okay, so that's the idea. Now, what amount of information you get is very limited. Okay, but you get some information about the object. So in fact, with just two telescopes, you can't do much. You need many telescopes. Each of them pairwise, you have to combine all the information. And the signal will be very weak. You know, a telescope as big as the Earth is wonderful. It can collect a lot of energy. But if I put, you know, six little fellows spread over the Earth, that's much weaker. So you need very, very sensitive instruments. But all of this is doable, it turns out. And there is a project called the Event Horizon Telescope Project, which is using millimeter waves spread over the telescope spread over the Earth. You know, these are some of the leaders, and many, many people are involved. I'm also part of this project. And this is going on right now. So let me tell you the telescopes that are being used for this. So these are telescopes spread all over the Earth. So there are a couple of telescopes in Hawaii. There's one in California, one in Arizona, one in Mexico, a couple of them in Chile, one in the South Pole of the Earth, which, if you haven't heard before, South Pole is a fantastic research station. You can find scientists there, the strong ones, okay? You and I cannot go. If you've grown up at below latitude 45 or 50, don't go there. But there are strong people on Earth, they go there, and they do some astronomy there. Then there are a couple of telescopes in Europe. These are all telescopes that can do millimeter wave astronomy, which is a very specialized technique, okay? There are only so many telescopes on Earth. So you combine all of them. All of them will look at your object, collect data, and then you have to bring all the data together and correlate it on a computer. It's a big, big project, but the point is it's doable. You get lots of pairs. In fact, let me show you this movie. So this is the Earth rotating, and you are Sagittarius A star, okay? You are in the direction of the galactic center, and you can see, as the Earth rotates, every pair of telescopes is looking at you when the Earth comes in the right direction, and it's making measurements and storing it in tape. And then you bring all the tapes together, and on the computer, later on, you correlate and you do interesting things. So that's the project. You can ask, what will we see? It won't look like that interstellar movie picture, okay? That's a good picture, but it's a very special kind of system. That was a system where the black hole had a flat disk around it. We are fairly confident that our galactic center does not have a flat disk around it. It's a much thicker object. So let me show you what we think. So this is again a simulation, similar to what I showed earlier. So a couple of simulations. This is the one that is similar to our galactic center. This is actually done by my student, Andrew Shale. You know, the picture, the details don't matter. But this is density. Look at it. It's not a flat sheet. This is the black hole. The disk is rotating like this. It's a big, fat, fluffy object. And this is going to be producing radiation all over the place. And you're going to be observing it from some direction. We don't know which direction, but some random direction is what we are observing. And you look at this and you say, you know, maybe I won't see this ring. Maybe I won't see this black region. What am I going to do? I'm going to probably just see a mess. But in fact, you know, I told you that that ring and the dark shadow has nothing to do with accretion. It is a property of space-time, right? So you take this simulation and pretend that you're doing an observation with the Event Horizon Telescope. This is what, if this will run, yeah. This is a movie of what that accretion disk might look like if the simulation got it right. You know, it's all random, turbulent, things are all churning around, but you see, there's one very, very solid fixed feature. There's always this ring, a very special ring, and you know, we know exactly what the size of that ring should be because it's just gravity. We know the mass of the black hole. So I can predict exactly how big the ring should be, and whatever junk may be happening around, that shadow will always be present. Even if you took one still image or you make a whole movie, you should see that. So that would be a great confirmation of general relativity and gravity and bending of light and everything, okay? And finally, you can believe Interstellar, the movie. You know, if you didn't understand the ending, maybe now you'll understand the ending of that movie after you see all this. But in addition, there's all this other stuff. This is all physics associated with the gas. I'm eagerly waiting for that because there is so much physics here. The jet is going like this, okay? This is just the beginning of the jet. I would like to see how the jet forms, how it goes. This is all for the future, okay? But this is a project that is ongoing. I'll tell you, it's a challenging project. I better stop now. You know, technologically it is challenging, okay? Let's be very honest about it, but astronomers know how to handle it. You need a lot of people doing, smart people doing a lot of very hard work. They can handle it. It's also politically very challenging. You know, these telescopes are, you know, they are rare. Millimeter wave telescopes, every country is so proud of the telescope it's got. Now you got to get 9 or 10 countries to all agree. We want to observe this galactic center all at the same time. We won't do anything else. We'll give you the telescope, go and observe. That is really hard. See, the chairman of ISRO is shaking his head. He knows how hard it is to get all the countries to work together. That's the problem we are facing here. And of course, there's a lot of image processing and all that. Nevertheless, it's been done once, okay? First observations were done in April last year, 2017. And 8 telescopes, I think, worked simultaneously. Conditions were good. Good data were collected. Most of the data has been brought to the central processing. It's all getting processed right now. It's happening. Except the data in the South Pole was stuck in the South Pole, you know. April is a bad time in the South Pole. You know, here we are saying, summer is coming and all that. That's terrible time. That's when winter is coming in South Pole. So they did the observations and the tapes were stuck there until end of November, December. Finally, a plane came out. It brought the tapes. Now it is being correlated. And we are expecting first results sometime this year. I can't tell you when, but a lot of people are working very hard. Hopefully, we will get an image. Hopefully, we'll see the shadow and, you know, the ring-like thing, and maybe learn also something about the accretion. I'm waiting for the movies. You know, if this is successful, then in principle, you could try and get movies, low-resolution movies of what's going on in the center. It's a big field that I think could open up, assuming this experiment is successful. So let me stop here. As I said, I just picked a few topics. There's a lot more one can say, but bullet points, we have different kinds of black holes in the universe, big ones, ordinary stellar mass ones. There is this very interesting connection between the supermassive black holes and the galaxy bulge. We think it's related to jets. Jets are how they are talking. And the jets get their power, we think, from the black hole spin. It all looks very good, but I would like to see that maybe directly with a movie of our galactic center. We will see whether that happens. But in any case, simulations, they are going to be very powerful in this whole field. and we are going to get hopefully some real data on the black hole at the center of our galaxy. So let me stop there. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ramesh, for this wonderful talk. I'm sure you have many questions. So people who want to ask a question, please raise your hands and one of our volunteers would come and give you a mic. Please wait till, let me start from there.
I just want to ask, what is the average temperature in the black hole? What is the average temperature?
Average temperature of a black hole.
Ooh. Okay. There are two ways of answering that. You can ask, what is the temperature of the gas that's falling into the black hole? Okay? That is what we observe. It is the radiation that comes out. So, if I look at one of those X-ray binaries, that gas is hot enough to make X-rays. So, its temperature is around 10 to the 7 Kelvin, maybe 10 to the 8 Kelvin. If I look at a, because there's not a single answer, okay, I'm going to give you many answers. If I look at a quasar, the bright objects in the galactic centers, that guy will have a temperature of around 10 to the 5 Kelvin, maybe a little bit less, 30,000 to 100,000 degrees Kelvin. Turns out that a bigger black hole generally has a lower temperature. It's very bright, but the temperature is lower. But our galactic center black hole, it's a different kind of an animal. It's not like a quasar. I won't go into the details. This one, Sagittarius A star, we think has got extremely hot gas. So we think the protons, it's all ionized gas, the protons probably have a temperature almost 10 to the power of 12 Kelvin near the black hole. And the electrons are probably between 10 to the 10 and 10 to the 11 Kelvin. Even though it's a supermassive black hole, under the conditions here, it's extremely hot gas. So the answer is, it's different in different systems. Okay?
Thanks. I have another question. You said that Andromeda strain and the Milky Way will be colliding in the future. That's what is predicted.
Can you hold your mic, please?
Sorry? My name is Jayant.
Just hold your mic close.
Yeah, and when those two galaxies collide, I want to know what would be the result, because people are speculating different things. What do you see it as?
Okay. So yeah, Andromeda, which is M31, neighboring galaxy, a big galaxy, approximately the size of our galaxy, the Milky Way, it's coming towards us. So Andromeda and our Milky Way galaxy will collide in, I think, a couple of billion years. We don't have to worry yet, but it will happen, okay? It's coming. We are gravitationally bound, it's going to come. And it's going to do something like that movie I showed you, right? The two disks. In fact, it's a very good movie. Our galaxy, Milky Way, is a disk galaxy with a bulge. Andromeda is also a disk galaxy with a bulge. So that movie was a very good example of what might happen. So yeah, they will come, they will collide, there'll be some swashing. It'll become a single galaxy at the end of the day, okay? So it'll become a single galaxy. Most likely, it'll become a big elliptical galaxy. The disks will disappear. It's not like we will be hit by anything, okay? Galaxies are so dilute, you can send two galaxies through each other. The stars will just go through, okay? So it's not like some other star is going to come and hit us. So that'll be fine. The sky may look a little brighter because now there are two galaxies around us. But it doesn't mean the galaxies just go away because gravity is powerful. It'll finally merge, become a single galaxy. Each of these galaxies has got a black hole in the middle, right? Our galaxy has got 4 × 10⁶ solar mass black hole. Andromeda has a black hole, I think, a couple of times 10 to the 7, 3 × 10⁷, roughly. So these two black holes will come to the center. Okay, they will merge. They'll become a single bigger black hole. They will become then a very bright supermassive black hole. It'll become a quasar, according to the standard story. So it'll become an extraordinarily bright, it'll outshine all the stars. It'll become very, very bright. It'll probably produce jets and, if, you know, it'll start, you know, churning the galaxy. It may do stuff. Whether we or our successors have to worry is less obvious. still quite far away, okay? It may just become a very bright object. It, if it produces enough ultraviolet and X-rays, and if they can reach us, that may be trouble, because it can get rid of the ozone, and you know, then we may all die through just genetic mutations. But other than that, it's sufficiently far away, nothing much should happen.
Hello, sir. Thank you for the lecture. I have two questions. First one is, how is a black hole formed? Is it like after the death of a star, or how is it formed? And second one is, how was the discovery of gravitational waves related to black hole? Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Let's start with the first one. So I told you there are two kinds of black holes. The small black holes, the ones with a few to, say, up to 30 or 40 solar masses, we have a pretty good idea how they were formed. They are generally formed when very massive stars die. Okay? So I should mention this. All stars have finite lifetimes. Even our sun will die after another 5 billion years. So, and big massive stars actually don't live very long. They are born, they shine very brightly, and they die quickly. So over the age of the universe and the age of our galaxy, many, many massive stars have formed, lived their lives, and they have died. When a very massive star dies, we think it makes a black hole. Okay, you have to be more massive than some limit, much, much bigger than the sun. The sun will not become a black hole. The sun will become what's called a white dwarf. And then there are some other kinds of stars which are more massive than the sun, but less than this other limit. They will become so-called neutron stars. But if you go to a really massive star, when it dies, the only thing it can do is become a stellar mass black hole. The supermassive black holes, we don't have a good idea. Okay? Some people think initially maybe they just started as an ordinary stellar mass black hole, and then they kept eating and eating and eating and eating and became so fat they ended up at 10 to the 9 solar mass. You know, it's very hard to do that, and there's just not enough time in the life of the universe, and not enough gas probably. So that's one story. Other people say somehow when galaxies form, by some magic, in the middle, you automatically form maybe already a 10 to the 5 solar mass black hole. Then you can grow by eating and become whatever, 4 times 10 to the 6 or 10 to the 8 or whatever. I don't know which one to believe. Maybe it's something else. Let's just say that's a mystery. Okay. Now, what was your second thing about the gravitational waves? Gravitational waves, that discovery, really is a victory for the theory of gravity, okay? Because this was a prediction, 100-year-old prediction. And even Einstein was waffling, is it really true or not? Like black holes, you know, he didn't believe black holes, and I think half his time he didn't believe gravitational waves either. And he never thought it would be discovered. But scientists and engineers in particular were so smart, they built a device that could measure it. So the discovery is a great discovery and a great vindication of the theory of gravity. But the connection to black hole is the very first object they detected was a binary black hole, two black holes in orbit around each other. And people had been theorizing that there would be binary black holes in the universe. Nobody had ever seen a binary black hole before, because a binary black hole does not make electromagnetic radiation. We have seen black holes with normal stars. We have seen binary black holes, but not two black holes. One black hole and one normal star. Accretion disk, you see electromagnetic radiation, we can do that. But if you've got just two black holes, and there's no gas around them, there's nothing, there's no way to find them except through gravitational waves, and that was this great discovery. So that's the connection to black holes. Okay, the point mass is theory. Theory says all the mass is sitting in the point. Around that point is the event horizon, okay? We never receive any information from inside the event horizon. So as far as we are concerned, whether it's a point or it's distributed inside the horizon, we cannot tell the difference because no signal will reach us. All we measure is the mass outside the horizon. We see the gas outside the horizon. And even those images and movies I showed towards the end, They are all talking about the gas which is accreting outside the horizon. What goes on inside the horizon is beyond our direct observational reach. Theory will give us the answer. Theory says, once the stuff has gone in there, all it can do is become a singularity. So that is theory. I don't think we are going to ever confirm that. And in fact, it's that singularity that bothers a lot of scientists. As I said, it bothered Einstein. It certainly bothers me, okay? I would like to know exactly what that singularity, because it's got some very weird properties. And one of the possibilities is that this singularity infinite density is a consequence of using classical physics. General relativity is classical physics. It's a generalization of Newtonian gravity with relativity. Meanwhile, we have quantum mechanics. And quantum mechanics has got uncertainty principle and all these things. So there's nothing like a point. Everything is fuzzy, right? So the great hope in fundamental physics, you know, people like Rajesh, this is what they do, is to find a theory that will merge quantum mechanics and gravity and come up with a more complete description of a black hole. Hopefully, the outside will all look the same, okay? For these supermassive, big, massive objects, it should all be classical physics. But the story will change as you go in towards the singularity, and it won't be a point, it'll be some fuzzy stuff. Rajesh will tell you it's all strings. That's why it's called string theory. But you know, who knows? But, right. So it's a very disturbing feature of a black hole. At the moment, our theory says it's a point. Yeah.
Thank you for the lecture. I've heard that black hole, it bends. I mean, it's like curves space and time. So what does it mean for time to curve? Like, does it make sense? And the second thing is that, what is it, how does gravitational wave propagate?
Good. So let me take the second part. Gravitational wave propagation, to a pretty good approximation, is just like light propagation. So if I sent a gravitational wave past a gravitating object, it will be deflected, just like a light ray is deflected, okay? So it goes at the speed of light. It's a wave phenomenon. It feels the curvature of space and time, and all of the things that we normally talk about will influence the propagation of gravitational waves as well. So that will all be the same. It's just that it's not electromagnetic. It is a disturbance in the fabric of space-time. Okay. Now you asked, what does it mean time is, you know, stretching, bending, and all that? Well, you know, if you have learned special relativity, you already know that time is weird. There is no such thing as a universal time that is true for everyone. You know, Einstein discovered that already in 1905, that moving objects, their clocks go slower compared to somebody who is stationary. So space and time are intricately tied together. If you have motions, both space and time are modified. This is why we talk about space-time. And the general theory of relativity says, more than all this, if you have gravity, that has additional distortions to space-time. So it stretches space or squeezes space, it changes time, and does very weird things. And let me now tell you one of the things that is most disturbing about the singularity. You see, when you've got a universe or a space-time, you think that, you know, objects will move around in this universe. It goes to different spatial positions as a function of time. And let's say if you are an immortal person, you're God, okay? And you got your clock, you can go around, you go all the different places in the space, your clock keeps running, and you know, there's no reason for anything to stop. You just keep on going. Now this black hole is weird. If you try to go into the black hole with your clock, I said that you will get squeezed down to the singularity. Okay, that's not very nice, but it'll happen. You'll go there, but what the theory says is your clock will just stop. Time will stop. It's not like you go get squeezed to the center and then you live forever as an infinite density, you know, point. Time actually just stops, it dies, okay? This is one of the weird things. This is why the classical physics, And maybe string theory will give you the answer, exactly what happens. But right now, the theory is in some sense incomplete when it talks about singularity. There are the so-called incomplete geodesics. Essentially what it means is you can go, and it's not just that you come to rest and stay there forever. It's like you kind of, you know, I don't know what to call it, but time just stops.
So let's take one quick break from this audience, because there are a lot of several people watching the YouTube stream, and there is one interesting question from there. How do the relativistic jets overcome the pull of gravity?
Oh. Right.
So how do the relativistic jets overcome the pull of gravity?
Right. Okay. So if you, since we can do the simulations, we can actually look at this stuff in detail, right? You can ask what's happening. So maybe I can show a movie, maybe?
Yeah.
Okay. So let me, I have a slide of some sort. So let me first say in words. So we think the relativistic jet is created by magnetic fields in the vicinity of a spinning black hole. Okay, so let me now see if I've got a... This is a simulation of a jet. This is the one I wanted to show. Okay, so we think the way this works is the following. You have this accretion disk. The accretion disk has got some gas. It's got magnetic fields. And let us say that there is, as a toy example, there is one magnetic field stretching. So this is my black hole. This is just stretching from plus infinity to minus infinity. Okay, and this is sitting in some plasma. All the details are irrelevant. This is my black hole. And this black hole is spinning like this. Okay, so axis is vertical. It's spinning round and round. Now, one of the very interesting properties of a spinning black hole is the following. We already talked about distortion of space and stretching and all that. A spinning black hole does one more thing. It doesn't just stretch, it actually drags space-time. So if I have a black hole spinning like this, it's as if the external space is being pulled around by the black hole in the same direction as the spin. Okay? So the whole of space-time is going round and round with a black hole. So in this illustration here, what happens is this field line is going to get pulled in towards the black hole by the action of gravity. Normally, you would just say, there's no angular momentum here, just sitting there. So it should just fall into the black hole, but instead, watch what happens. So it's getting pulled in, but it's sitting next to a spinning black hole. And because of the spinning black hole, space-time is being dragged, and what you'll find is that the magnetic field gets dragged along with the space-time. And see, it doesn't fall in, it comes to the front. And then it goes round. This is all due to the dragging of space-time. It goes round and round and round. It's still falling into the center. And do you see this nice spiral corkscrew pattern? Yeah. See, just watch how it develops. Okay, as it keeps going, it just keeps on going. And that's, in fact, the beginning of my jet. This corkscrew is kind of like a wave, and this is what is carrying away all the energy in the jet. Nothing is coming from inside the black hole. Everything is outside, okay, as you saw. The field line is entirely outside. It is the dragging that is allowing the black hole to influence the magnetic field, and that corkscrew pattern, you can actually do the calculations, it is carrying away energy. So we think the way the jet works is it's an electromagnetic phenomenon. It's, for technical details, this is a helical Alfvén wave. Okay, you've got a straight magnetic field line. You're setting up a helical wave. It's an Alfvén wave. And it's that wave which is propagating both up and down, which is carrying the energy. And if you ask, where did that energy come from? Finally, it came from the spin of the black hole. If you did the calculation carefully, you'll see, after the jet has carried away energy, your black hole will be spinning slightly slower because it gave up some of its spin energy to the jet. But the fact that everything is outside the horizon means that there is nothing like a speed limit. if you give enough energy, the material can escape from the pull of the black hole. And there is enough power here. I don't know if this is a complete answer, but basically, if you are worried about how can you escape from inside the black hole, the answer is none of this is happening inside the black hole. It's all outside. And outside, you know, things can escape.
Thank you.
May I request people to stick to one question? Just think of your best question.
Okay, all right. So given that as you approach the event horizon, everything slows down, time included, why is it that light doesn't? Why is it that light doesn't slow down?
It's a very subtle question. Thank you. So let's say you are approaching the horizon of a black hole, okay? So you can approach, and let's say, the horizon, and I'm watching you. So I will watch you, and everything will appear to go slower and slower. And in fact, I will never see you cross the horizon because it takes longer and longer for any signal. Let's say you have a flashlight and you're sending me signals. It takes longer and longer for that signal to reach me. And so I might be wondering, who cares about the horizon? Everything is slow near the horizon. Nothing much is happening. But let me tell you, you are going in, right? And you have a watch. In your watch, there's no slowing down, nothing. Life will just go on as usual. Before you know it, you'll be through the horizon. And before you can say, oh my God, you're at the singularity and you're finished. In fact, time, your watch also stops. There's no time. So this is an extreme example of how in relativity, time means different things for different people. For me, the external observer, it looks as if everything is very, very slow. But for the light ray or you or anything that's dropped in, time goes as usual in their own frame. And it's all very finite. In a very finite time, you've gone through the horizon and disappeared. So that's what happens to the light ray. I shoot my light ray because the light is a very extreme example. But let's say I throw a particle, which is going at a good speed. In its own frame, if it had a watch, it's a very finite time. It's gone and disappeared in the singularity. No. Speed of light is speed of light. It's a universal constant. In every frame, the speed of light is the same.
If nothing can escape from a black hole, how do black holes lose energy through Hawking radiation?
That's a great question. So nothing can escape from a black hole so long as you're doing classical physics. And when I'm doing astronomy or astrophysics, I only look at classical black holes because the quantum features of the black hole are not relevant for our observations, our phenomena. But once you think of the black hole as a quantum object, then it turns out that a black hole can produce its own radiation. This is Hawking radiation that you talked about. It's a very low-level radiation. In fact, all of our black holes that I'm talking about and that people are observing, they probably are also emitting Hawking radiation, but it's negligibly small compared to everything else we observe. But if I could take one of these black holes and put it all by itself and have nothing around it falling in, and if I had really sensitive instruments, I probably would see the Hawking radiation coming out, and it'll come out at a very low temperature. So, you know, even a black hole of mass of a few times the mass of the sun, I think its temperature is 10 to the minus 8 Kelvin or some such thing. It's a very, very low temperature. And the bigger the black hole, the lower the temperature. So it's quantitatively, it's a very, very negligible phenomenon. But you're right. In principle, a black hole under the influence of quantum mechanics can radiate, does radiate, we think. We haven't detected it, but the theory says it should. And moreover, if you could wait long enough and don't let this black hole eat anything, it can disappear completely by evaporation. It can radiate, lose everything and disappear forever. But it takes too long, okay? Much longer than the age of the universe.
Okay, let us take another break. There are a lot of people in the spillover rooms of the planetarium, so they have sent some questions through post. One is, what does the jet expelled by supermassive black holes consist of?
Good. So the jet starts off with most of its power, we think, in the magnetic field. But of course, it's not just magnetic field. It is attached to ionized gas, plasma. The exact composition of that plasma is actually still under debate. Okay? The plasma that's coming in the accretion disk is normal gas. It'll be, you know, ionized hydrogen, helium, so protons, electrons, alpha particles, all just ordinary charges and the magnetic field. What goes out in the jet might be this, the same, some fraction of the same gas might be going out, so it'll be both protons and electrons being carried away. But for various theoretical reasons, people have speculated that maybe the most powerful jets are not made of electrons and protons, but actually electrons and positrons. So you still have the same charges, okay, plus and minus, plus E and minus E, but the plus E is not attached to a proton, but it's attached to a positron, which, as you know, is the same mass as an electron, just the opposite sign. Now, why do they want this? You can accelerate an electron-positron plasma much more easily than an electron-proton plasma. There's so much less mass. I mean, you know that the proton is almost 2,000 times heavier than an electron. So for the same amount of charge, if you have just electrons and positrons, it takes much less force to push it. And in certain models, at least, this whole acceleration through the spinning magnetic field, etc., to get the largest velocities, it turns out it's easier to do it with electrons and positrons rather than electron and proton. But I think it's still an open question. People have been trying for years and years through observations, through radio observations of these jets, to determine what is the composition of that thing, stuff inside there. As far as I know, it's still inconclusive. It's possible that some jets, the most rapidly moving jets, have a large amount of positrons. Maybe the more normal jets have mostly protons and electrons. We don't know. Maybe the simulations will answer us one of these days. Right now, at least, I don't know the answer.
We have another chicken and egg problem. Which came first, galaxy or the black hole? And there is another follow-up question, whether the black hole influences the shape and the nature of the galaxy, whether it becomes elliptical or spiral and so on.
Okay, first part. I don't know which came first. Okay. I don't know. If you believe this, one of the stories for making the supermassive black holes, namely, you form a galaxy, some massive star died, it made, let us say, a 50 solar mass black hole, and then that black hole kept on eating, and became 10 to the 8 solar masses. In that story, it's clear the galaxy formed first, okay? The galaxy formed first, it made big stars, those stars made small black holes, and then the small black holes became big black holes. I told you that there are problems with that story. It looks like there's not enough time, not enough conducive conditions for this to happen. So there's a second story, which says somehow or other the galaxy center spontaneously made a 10 to the 5 or 10 to the 6 solar mass black hole, which then maybe grew. In this story, it's like they formed together. So, you know, there's a whole big cloud of gas which coalesced, made the galaxy itself. Parts of it collapsed into lots and lots of stars. And somehow the center did something different because maybe there was more gas and everything was more focused. And it just spontaneously became a very, very massive object and a black hole. This would be a story where, you know, neither came first. They were all kind of coeval. But this is a story, okay? There's no real theory behind this. It's just somebody's vision of what might have happened. I am not aware of any popular story which said that the black hole came first and then the galaxy coalesced around it. But maybe that's what happened. But it's just that I haven't heard such a story. Was there something follow up on that?
Whether the black holes affect the nature of the galaxy, whether it becomes a spiral or elliptical.
Yeah. The question of why some galaxies become ellipticals and some become spirals is itself another very, very long standing question. The best guess is when this initial cloud collapsed and became the galaxy, its angular momentum probably decided whether it became a disk-like spiral galaxy or a more round elliptical galaxy. So it's like initial conditions, something to do with how much angular momentum did this piece of gas have relative to its mass. Okay, you can easily imagine, if you have more angular momentum, it's going to be spinning more, and maybe it'll become a more disk-like object. So in that story, the black hole has no role to play. Okay, the black hole also formed maybe by itself, but this was really determined by the initial angular momentum. However, there is a follow-up to this story. When galaxies merge, you can ask, what happens, right? And there is, I think, fairly strong evidence that you can start with spiral galaxies, disk-like galaxies, merge them, but when they merge, they preferentially make ellipticals, okay? So it's as if continued generations of mergers will keep converting spiral galaxies into ellipticals. Again, it has nothing to do with the black hole, at least. Maybe, maybe not. Maybe, you know, I showed you the movie. As the black holes combine and this jet comes out, maybe it's doing something to convert it into elliptical. But this seems to be the way the universe works. So it's possible that, you know, we had a question about Milky Way and Andromeda colliding. It is possible, and I won't stake my life on it, but, you know, this is 2 billion years away. Why not? I'll stake my life on it. It's it'll probably make an elliptical, okay? According to current paradigm, when our two galaxies meet, they will become a big elliptical. Wonderful, great question. The question was on naked singularities. So, the black hole I talked about in this talk is an object with a singularity, but the singularity is not visible. So there was this other question about, you know, how can there be a singularity, can I see it, etc. You cannot see it in these black holes because we have a horizon. So there's this horizon, we can only see things outside the horizon. The singularity is hidden inside the horizon somewhere. We can work it out by theory. We can solve the equations, but we'll never see it, okay? This is a black hole. So now you can ask, is it possible that gravity can make a singularity without a horizon? Because if gravity could do that under some conditions, then we'll have what is called a naked singularity. It's a real singularity. Infinite density, all the mass is squeezed in. Huge gravity, because you know, if you take a finite amount of mass with zero radius, gm over r squared, you can imagine, it's going to infinity. So infinitely strong gravity, and we'll be able to see it. This will be fantastic. What's more fantastic is you can take the equations of general relativity, you can do model calculations, and you can actually make naked singularities. They are allowed by the theory. For a long time, and I think even today, there is a conjecture called the cosmic censorship conjecture. This was proposed by the great mathematical physicist, Roger Penrose. So Penrose said, there must be a cosmic censorship principle in the universe. And the censorship just means you'll never see the naked singularity. You don't want to see naked stuff, right? You want to put some clothing around it, and the horizon is supposed to be the clothing. So the conjecture says, forget what the equations say, somehow or other, nature will always figure out a way to hide every singularity inside a horizon. But at the same time, you got solutions. In fact, one of the people who has done quite a lot of very interesting work on this is Professor Pankaj Joshi at TIFR. He has written whole books on this. And he has actually shown that there are clear, well-defined, naked singularity solutions with very reasonable initial conditions which can form. And now the question is, does the universe actually have these initial conditions? Does it make it? But it's allowed by the theory. This is exactly the same thing as Einstein's problem, right? Einstein's problem was, my equations allow, not naked. He was looking at a singularity inside a black hole, but that bothered him. Something must be wrong with the theory. Now what we are finding is the same equations not only allow black holes, they even allow naked singularities. It would be wonderful if we could observe one of these guys, Because just imagine, you will be receiving signals from this infinite gravity region. We don't know what's happening there, but if it is string theory, you know, there are probably strings wriggling around there. And, you know, maybe we can see, we'd like to make a movie of that wriggling string. So it'll be wonderful. We'll get some completely new information about quantum gravity. But if Penrose is right, maybe there is a principle that we haven't yet understood where such objects are just ruled out by physics. So it's an open question, but the solutions exist, okay? And some of the best work is being done here in India.
So I think this is a very good time to take a break, and I suggest that we take the rest of the questions over a cup of coffee outside. And before we disperse, I would like to announce the next Kaapi with Curiosity lecture, which is on the Sunday of 25th February by Professor Urbashi Sinha at the RRI, Raman Institute. And she's going to talk about a fascinating world of photons, superposition, and entanglement. So we will hope to see you all on 25th February. So before we disperse this evening, let's give a big hand to Professor Narayan. And please, please join us for a cup of kaapi outside the hall. People in the spillover rooms are also